Hello. My name is Nat Trotman. I'm an associate curator here at the Guggenheim Museum and co-curator with Carmen Jimenez of the James Turrell exhibition. I'm very pleased to welcome you to Sensing Space, a symposium on the work of James Turrell. This is the final public program that we've organized for the exhibition. The exhibition itself has been overwhelmingly successful, widely hailed by the critics, and so far we've welcomed over 400,000 visitors in the 3 months of the show, with a week left to go. So making this one of the most popular exhibitions ever held at the Guggenheim. As I mentioned, the exhibition does close in just 5 days, so tonight will actually be one of the final opportunities to get to see it. The symposium, at the conclusion of the symposium, there will be a viewing of the exhibition, which will be a very special moment considering that there's not so many people here and certainly not as many people as there are during the day. But first, today we're joined by three prestigious scholars who will speak in turn about various aspects of and context for understanding James Turrell's art. After the individual presentations, there will be a 30-minute break during which light refreshments will be provided outside of the auditorium. And as I mentioned, there will be a viewing of the exhibition after the symposium, but please note that your program ticket does not actually include museum admission. So during that break, you'll need to stay around here and not try to get into the museum. But don't worry, because you'll, again, have the good view after. Now, I would like to briefly introduce the three speakers that we have this afternoon before turning over the podium. The first person we'll be hearing from is Thomas Crowe. Crowe is Provostial Fellow and Rosalie Salo Professor of Modern Art at the Institute of Fine Arts here in New York. He received his BA in Government from Pomona College in 1969 and his PhD in Art History from the University of California at Los Angeles in 1978. Dr. Crowe is a contributing editor to Art Forum and is the author of numerous journal articles and catalog essays, far more than I could list here. Among his many books are Painters and Public Life in 18th Century Paris from 1985, Modern Art and the Common Culture from 1996, The Rise of the 60s, American and European Art in the Era of Dissent from 1996, Emulation, Making Artists for Revolutionary France in 1995, and The Intelligence of Art in 1999. He's the recipient of many honors, including a National Endowment for the Humanities Fellowship. He has also held teaching positions at the California Institute of the Arts, University of Chicago, Princeton University, the University of Michigan, Ann Arbor, the University of Sussex, Yale, and the University of Southern California. He served as director of the Getty Research Institute from 2000 to 2007, after which he came to New York, as I mentioned, to join the Institute of Fine Arts. Our second speaker is Miwon Kwon. Miwon Kwon is professor and chair in the Department of Art History at UCLA. She trained in architecture, holds an MA in photography, and has extensive curatorial experience from her tenure at the Whitney Museum of American Art in the early 1990s. She received her PhD in architectural history and theory from Princeton in 1998, the same year in which she joined the faculty at UCLA to teach contemporary art history. She was also the founding co-editor and publisher of Documents, a journal of art, culture, and criticism that ran from 1992 to 2004. And serves on the advisory board of October magazine. She's the author of One Place After Another, Site-Specific Art and Locational Identity from 2002, as well as lengthy essays on the work of many contemporary artists, including Francis Elise, Michael Asher, Sai Kuo Chang, Barbara Kruger, Christian Marclay, Anna Mendieta, Gabriel Orozco, Jorge Pardo, Richard Serra, and James Turrell. With Philip Kaiser, she recently co-organized a major historical exhibition entitled Ends of the Earth, Land Art to 1974, which opened at the Museum of Contemporary Art in Los Angeles in 2012 and traveled to the Haus der Kunst in Munich. Finally, we will hear from Mark Taylor. Taylor is chair of Department of Religion at Columbia University. He holds a doctorate in philosophy from the University of Copenhagen, a PhD in religion from Harvard University, and before that, a bachelor's from Wesleyan University. He's a leading figure in debates around postmodernism and has written on topics ranging from philosophy, religion, literature, and art and architecture to education, media, science, technology, and economics. His many books include Disfiguring, Art, Architecture, Religion from 1994, About Religion, Economies of Faith and Virtual Culture from 1999, Confidence Games, Money and Markets in a World Without Redemption from 2006, and most recently, Refiguring the Spiritual, Boyce, Barney, Turrell, and Goldsworthy from 2012. Among his awards and honors are Professor of the Year from the Carnegie Foundation for the Advancement of Teaching in 1995, the Rector's Medal from the University of Helsinki in 1993, and a Guggenheim Fellowship in 1979-80. Beyond his scholarly work, Taylor also contributes to the New York Times, Los Angeles Times, and various other periodicals. So with that very brief introduction, which does not do justice to any of our speakers' full careers and thinking, we will shortly turn over the podium to Tom Crow. But first, a few more notes of housekeeping. Just please note that photography is not permitted during the symposium or in the museum upstairs. If you have questions for the presenters today, you have two different ways of communicating those to us. You should have received a card with your program, which you can write your questions on. And when we go for our break, you can turn those into a member of our education staff and they will get to me for the second portion of the program. Or if time allows, during the moderated discussion or at the end of the moderated discussion, we have two microphones at the front of the aisles and we can take real-time questions from you then also. Also, today's symposium is being live streamed, so we encourage those of you who are watching online to join the conversation on Twitter by using the hashtag Turrell. And with that, I would like to welcome Tom Crow to the stage. Thank you.
Well, many, many thanks for that warm welcome, and to Nat for his gratifying introduction, to Nat and Carmen for inviting us. And my pleasure is joining very distinguished company as part of this discussion, and I hope I can hold up my end. Talking first, I think, comes with the territory when you're talking about the youth of an artist. The formative period when a career direction comes into focus, it's an area I've always been especially interested in and naturally gravitated to it when I was asked to say something about James Turrell. But the first person you're going to see in my presentation is not James Turrell. You're looking at a photo of the young Helene Weiner. Well known, I should think, to lots of people here, first for her work in New York, the groundbreaking shows at Artist Space in the later 1970s, and then her long and influential tenure at the Metro Pictures Gallery. But the date here is 1971. The Renaissance painting in the background establishes the scene as an art gallery. The Montgomery Gallery of Pomona College in Claremont, California, to be specific, where she had only recently been appointed director. All well and good, but the silver service in front of her is another matter. For a faculty tea to be held in the gallery, and as one of the few women members of the faculty at that time, Weiner was asked by the college president to pour the tea. Stunned and repelled by this request, she refused, and James Turrell, then teaching at Pomona, stepped in to rescue the situation by volunteering to do the pouring. As he describes the scene, quote, "I was in full Quaker regalia, wearing a full square-cut frock coat, and so I was in this outfit and I poured tea, and it just set off a firestorm," end of quote. Now, his bearded 19th century look in 71 seems far removed from his appearance in 1969 when he was collaborating with Robert Irwin in their never completed contribution to the Art and Technology exhibition at the LA County Museum of Art. So one might assume the Quaker costume to have been a one-off performance, but this picture survives, showing Weiner and Turrell on a student faculty trip to San Francisco, where his reflected image includes the hat still in place, much as he remembers his childhood times in the care of his devoutly Quaker grandmother. As he's recalled, quote, "She still wore the plain dress with the bonnet and had me wear the hat." Well, I think the occasion of the tea service speaks to Turrell's penchant in these years. After returning as a teacher to his undergraduate college, though still living more than an hour away at his studio in Santa Monica, penchant to fall in with the ethos of a place like Pomona, which encouraged interaction between faculty and students both outside and inside the classroom, just as his own teachers like James Dimitrion, Salvatore Grippi had done with him. So in that same year of 71, student assistance was instrumental in a piece he pulled off with red highway flares placed behind the colonnade of Pomona's massive classical Art Deco Bridges Auditorium. In Turrell's own description, quote, "I did this one piece called Burning Bridges. I had these sandboxes and put flares in them and reflectors and put them behind the columns of Big Bridges, the theater building. When the flares were set off, it just looked fantastic because it put the light right into the space, behind the columns, of course. And somebody reported that Bridges was on fire. They actually had the fire trucks come out, and I moved the crew to go to these different places right after they got it going. I was happy, and I'd go to the next place and prepare that and have it ready, while the graduate art chair, Roland Rees, had to explain to the firemen that this was an art piece, which was interesting for everyone at that moment." Well, in 2011, what's now the Pomona College Museum and Turrell restaged Burning Bridges, as you see in this short excerpt.
Let's go.
Complete with the arrival of the Claremont Fire Department.
Doctor, are you there?
Yeah. I told him 6
fire.
Bridges Auditorium, Big Bridges in local parlance, faces the open Marston Quadrangle at the heart of the old campus, the place where Turrell in his undergraduate days had landed and taken off in a small airplane. And I think that kind of retroactive spirit extended to his use of these incendiary materials in burning bridges, which goes back to the earliest phase of his art experiments before he hit on cool, invariant projected light as his signature medium. And nor was this the only occasion when reimmersion in his college environment brought out tendencies perhaps surprising to those only familiar with his use of steady light sources. In the next year, 1972, he enthusiastically pitched in when English department colleague Richard Barnes mounted an enormous and elaborate nocturnal pageant called The Death of Buster Quinine, a sacramental farce and fire opera. Using oversized platforms, props, and illuminations, Barnes staged the event inside the walls of a moribund quarry in the semi-desert terrain just adjacent to the campus. As the whole thing unfolded, spectators began to be confused with performers as all descended into the deep crater, with the night sky becoming a canopy overhead. As Turrell recalls, quote, "We did the big things with Richard Barnes and made these big figures that had explosives in them, and then we burned them out in the quarries." So we see Turrell really leaping in as a prime contributor to what made Claremont in those years such an unlikely center of creative ferment. He was close to Bastian Otter, who lived in his now iconic local bungalow during these very same years and showed among his first exhibitions at the college gallery under Weiner's auspices. By 1973, though, the contradictions between the advanced art scene and the conservative college community, very much in view in those Tea Party photographs, all that came to a head, leading to the nearly complete destruction of that scene, of that art scene, and its migration to places like UC Irvine, CalArts, or even New York. Accumulated tensions, exacerbated in particular by a series of provocations by performance artists in the spring of 1972, led to Weiner being fired the next year. In her support, the studio art faculty, more or less led by Turrell, which included also Louis Baltz, David Gray, Michael Brewster, and Guy Williams, all resigned as a body. Turrell has remembered the incident, and I quote, "When I turned in my resignation, I just started thinking about what to do next. And at the same time, I found out that I was being evicted from my studio by a real estate investment trust, the 51% owner of which was Barbara Streisand. I'd lost my job, and I was being evicted, while also coming to grips with the idea of not teaching at all anymore, even though I came from a family that values teaching so much." But he credits this demonstration of integrity with his receiving a National Endowment grant in the following year, but he's also described it as a Guggenheim grant. Whichever it was, in any event, he put it towards aviation fuel that he needed to keep flying around the Southwest seeking a site for a sustained large-scale project. After 7 months of doing this, he has said he first saw Roden Crater. Well, having begun his education that is to say his art education, in the fall of 1965 at the brand new campus of UC Irvine. He also, in 1973, finished his MFA degree, finished his MFA degree at the Claremont Graduate School. So we kind of need to ask what he was doing back in graduate school in the late 70s. In fact, being taught ostensibly by some of his teaching colleagues on the Pomona faculty. Haven't we heard the quotation over and over again about his leaving the UC Irvine MFA program in 1966, quote, "It was time to stop becoming an artist and start being one." These are photographs, by the way, place-establishing images taken by no less a witness than Ansel Adams of the Irvine campus, kind of rising, half-finished, out of raw ranch land. So the story, still repeated right up to the present moment, of his leaving Irvine in the spring of 66, encouraged, John Copeland says, by Copeland saying, one of his teachers there, "We've got nothing more to give you, you can go on." But yet, in the early 70s, he was not only back in a college environment teaching, but in fact, finishing his education, which leads to the question, why did he leave in the first place? Probably not for the reason generally given. Now, Turrell, when he's talking in an art context, rarely refers to an incident which must have occurred in the early part of 1966, about which he has rather freely spoken when he's talked to interviewers from general readership periodicals. Because alongside his art studies in 65-66 at Irvine, he also began a six-month period advising potential conscientious objectors to military service, all at the height of the war in Vietnam. "You might be surprised," he told David Pagel of the LA Times in 2009, "what you say over a period of 6 months. There was a couple. I took the woman to be the man's mother. She was not. She was an FBI agent. Everything the couple said was in truth a lie. And they just wanted to find me saying one thing, that I thought he should do this. I was positive I never had. I told my lawyer I never had. And then they had a tape of me out in the parking lot. And apparently I said this is what he should do. And that was enough. I was arrested and served time in prison," end quote. And just before this current trifecta of Turrell exhibitions we're enjoying at the moment, he forthrightly returned to the subject in an interview with Harper's Bazaar. Quote, "Everything I had been accused of, I had done, and more, but I didn't believe I should be punished. President Carter pardoned everybody we got out, but he didn't pardon the guys who helped them get out," end quote. So if one's looking for a reason why Turrell interrupted his formal education in art, then only a few months along, the trauma of arrest, trial, and jail time would seem a more powerful explanation than a vague desire to be an artist. And the ethos of the Irvine program, after all, had been one in which little distinction was drawn between teachers and students anyway, a condition he later replicated in Claremont when some of his Pomona faculty colleagues doubled, as I said, as his own graduate teachers. Now, the fact that he left Irvine in the spring of 66 but didn't rent his studio space in the old Mendota Hotel until the following autumn probably provides a fair estimate of the time that he was away. It also gives at least some psychological plausibility to the withdrawal that he went through during those years. And really staying out of sight for the most part until rather reluctantly to begin with, cajoled by department chair Maury Baden in 1970 to accept his invitation to start teaching at Pomona. John Copeland had arranged in 1967 for him to have a small show of light projection pieces, the ones he'd begun in graduate school and then refined in his Ocean Park studio, such as the works in the Afram series. But that was really his one significant foray into the public realm during all those years. The impact, though, of even a small sampling of these works was very large. The New Yorker Willoughby Sharp, who is a key underground opinion maker of this moment, wrote at the time, quote, "Turrell's refusal to show after invitations from Nick Wilder and Leo Castelli," he might have added Pace Gallery to that, "and vague reports of works with natural light constructed in the walls of his studio have made him a heroic figure for a younger generation of Los Angeles artists," end quote. Well, this talk is proceeding, I discover, by peeling back layers from what was arguably the end of the formative phase of his artistic career in the early 1970s, 73, 74. As each of these layers raises questions concerning the one that came before. And so it is with the wrenching hiatus in his graduate study and incarceration. The next question becomes, why, at draftable age, was Turrell counseling prospective conscientious objectors rather than seeking that status for himself? The reason lies in his having already completed his alternative service as a Quaker pacifist, as he once again has only selectively discussed in public venues. But his disclosures raise as many questions as they do in settling others. In 1993, an English reporter accompanied him to his Flagstaff Airport studio and described Turrell removing from a case, quote, "a military issue high altitude helmet with an anti-nuclear flash visor, a relic of the days in the early 60s when he flew secret missions over Tibet and the Himalayas for the United States government." He describes Turrell handling the helmet very delicately, placing it on a bench for the journalist to photograph, and saying, "This was never really issued to me, and I never had to return it," end of quote. Well, the journalist specifying the early 1960s as a date is just sort of barely falling into that particular time span and is typical of a kind of slipperiness of reported chronologies that that bear on Turrell's early life. The Tibetan uprising against Chinese rule began in 1959. In the same year that the Dalai Lama fled into exile in India. It's well known that the CIA was supporting the rebels and the Dalai Lama personally. Turrell spoke just recently, again to Harper's Bazaar, about unlisted planes whose pilots did not carry passports. In his words, "America has this shadow government It should stay in the shadows, but because it can't stand up in the light. Now, it's the case that the American Friends Service Committee, which pioneered the whole concept of alternative service as far back as the First World War, was in this period regularly supplying relief to refugees in zones of civil conflict all over the world. This Quaker connection helps explain how it might have been that Turrell came to undertake his own alternative service before he was even eligible for the draft. Or, by extension, would have needed to register for conscientious objector status, and that he entered Pomona in the fall of 1961 as a freshman, only a few months after his 18th birthday, remaining there through the normal 4 years until graduating in 1965. Now, having flown at high altitudes under a whole gamut of imaginable conditions, it's easy to see why he would have been drawn at Pomona to perceptual psychology as a concentration, and that pilots need to train for moments of extreme visual disorientation. But his initial direction in his art studies seems less likely. He remembers the strong impression that ceramics instructor John Mason, whom we see at the center of this photo, made on him on his arrival in Claremont. Quote, the way he conducted himself, you really got the feeling of what it was to be an artist. It would take too long on this occasion to describe how Claremont, through both Pomona and Scripps Colleges, became a focus for the new ceramics movement in America. In this photo, you're not only seeing Mason in the center, but the kind of godfather of the movement, Peter Volkos, the darker figure at the left, and Paul Solner on the right, who would join the Scripps faculty for a very long and very influential tenure in these same years. Turrell puts it this way, there was really this clay thing going on, and that had a lot to do with Claremont. Speaking of Mason individually, he says, Mason actually created large-scale sculptures, and then he made these brick kilns, brick pieces, which were inspired by all of the kilns he had to make to fire the large sculptural pieces he had made before. So I think that was very interesting to me. Of course, my interest was in light, and these guys had giant pug mills for bronze casting. It was sort of a manly, macho kind of art. And if you think about it, now with Roden Crater, I have sort of come full circle. The crater is one of the largest high fire bowls. So flying as a humanitarian Quaker, on the one hand, and this choice of ceramics as his initial medium, on the other, would seem to be, you know, widely disparate and separated experiences. But I think they possess an underlying bond, which lay in the concept of service. I spoke not long ago with another artist, John Ware, who was a friend of Turrell's, just 1 year behind him at Pomona. Ware told me that Turrell's Quaker beliefs barred him from making anything that didn't have a use. Now, plainly, ceramics allowed him to join in the art scene without violating that stricture. When he arrived at UC Irvine for his first concentrated study of art, his first pieces were made with incendiary gases, the precursors to the flares from burning bridges, and also an extension of the heat and light of the kiln. They consume themselves in their making, so leaving no object behind. The light projection pieces that followed shortly afterwards, you could see as elegantly bridging both the positive and negative poles of aspiration he brought out of his high wire stint of alternative service in Southeast Asia. First, the deep, hard-won knowledge that human perceptual fields can depart drastically from everyday norms. And secondly, that objects without utility are vain and prideful. Light may hover between wave and particle, but it is not matter, and therefore no object. As he has said only recently, quote, art is not something Quakers do. Art is vanity. Strange thing is, the more I've been in it, the more I realize that that's probably the case. Thank you very much for your attention.
Good afternoon. Congratulations first to Carmen Jimenez and Nat Trotman for the realization of this exceptional exhibition project. Thanks to them and also other staff members of the Guggenheim Museum, particularly Christina Yang and Alan Seiss, for facilitating the logistics of my participation in the symposium. My presentation is going to be quite different. An approach than what you just heard. It is a series of contradictory and very ambivalent thoughts that reflect my attempt to articulate the very contradictory aspects of Turrell's work in relation to art historical and cultural political issues, admittedly very sketchily and very speculatively. I will not address any one work in particular, nor this exhibition in particular. My thoughts are broad, very broad strokes, generalizing, a little bit wild, on Turrell's overall practice based on having seen a number of his works in the US and abroad, including The Road and Crater. So let me start with what might sound totally crazy. Turrell's work produces blindness. Or more accurately, his work requires blindness. As much as his art expands our perceptual faculties beyond familiar limits, it is predicated on not seeing as much as newly seeing. I will explain this necessary blindness as I go along. With most of Turrell's work, especially since the early light projections like this one, there's one upstairs, I think, that offered illusory objects floating in space, to see his work means you encounter no image, no object, no thing to look at, really, nothing to focus on. Speaking of, I'm particularly speaking of Dark Spaces series, or the Ganzfeld, of which this is one of them, or the perceptual cell kind of isolation tank projects also. The isolation pieces involve an individual chamber, a chamber for an individual, usually to lie down in, with very fast-paced light sequences for overstimulation of your eyes to produce a brain state, brain waves, similar to when you meditate. Now, many people actually find it claustrophobic and can't quite endure those works. But in any case, I'm kind of generalizing about these kinds of works. In these works, there's nothing for your eyes to lean on. This is a phrase of Carl Andre's when he was faced with the possibility of doing an outdoor work for the first time. It describes his fear of facing an open natural landscape with an endless horizon. There was nothing for his eyes to lean on. His eyes kept going. This is why he said he didn't want to be a land artist in the mid-60s. At least when the minimalist Dan Flavin took over a space with his fluorescent lights, one could fix on fixtures. There was something to look at and contemplate as image or object, as offering something representational illusionistic, perhaps the space, or non-representational and literal, or both, or neither. And precisely this oscillation, this play between these poles was being the interest of the artist. Or, comparatively, when Olafur Eliasson filled the enormous turban hall at the Tate Modern with light and haze to mimic a weather system in 2003, he at least made a sun and a sky to orient his viewers in the vast space. In contrast, in Turrell's work, there is no such substitution of a false sun or sky to conceptually lean on, even. There is no metaphor, no symbolism, no iconography, no semiotics, no narrative, no meaning, so no language, no interpretation, no history, just perceptual sensation. His work reaches to supersede even abstraction, the modernist dream of freedom from the burdens of representation. For if early modernists pursued form, color, and materials in non-representational or non-objective ways, as in themselves somehow expressive, Turrell pursues light not so much as inherently expressive, but as simply a condition of reality, or more accurately as a conditioning actuality of what constitutes our sense of reality. I am both enthralled and terrified by Turrell's work. In his work, I experience the phenomenon of seeing myself seeing within the uncertainty of a seemingly limitless space, depthless darkness or brightness produced by a mysterious luminosity that seems sourceless. Light and color is both there and not there, outside of me and inside of me. And if I stay with this phenomenon, following the nuances and adjustments in myself in this act of seeing, occupying and enveloped by the light and color, I feel attentive, strangely alert, my perceptual capacities heightened and intensified. I can feel almost ecstatic. And that's not me, just so you know. But at the same time, I also feel myself zooming out, checking out, mesmerized, hypnotized. Am I dreaming? How long have I been here? Did the light change, or is it just me? Where is my body? Is this color a hallucination? I can feel high, in an altered state, tripping. On one hand, I appreciate, like so many others, Turrell's extraordinary work as beautiful, sublime, ethereal, meditative, relaxing, spiritual, transporting, if not transcendent, wondrous, awe-inspiring. I totally get the wow effect and the 4,000 people who have come to see the show. I have felt myself in a state of grace, I think, like I walked into a Barnett Newman, or better, a Mark Rothko painting, the pictorial flatness of their color field canvases having become encompassing environments. I have honestly experienced a sense of exaltation and revelation, intuited a connection to a cosmological sense of time and space in the encounter with light that seems both ancient and primordial. The artist favors such an association, Aten, the title of the rotunda piece, the disk of the sun in ancient Egyptian mythology, or futuristic. You know, I think of Star Trek. Perhaps I have even encountered something divine. And maybe the pieces that, for me, have had the most potent impact are the ones that actually you see the sky space pieces, this one at MoMA, at PS1. The other one, the Quaker Live Oak Meeting House in Houston. James did say that if he could blow the roof off of the Guggenheim, he would have made a sky space here, too. So I appreciate his work in almost all the terms that have been put to the work. But on the other hand, as light is made visible, not as something that makes other things visible, but itself becomes available to my vision, physical and dense, substantial and thick, I feel vaporized into this formless immateriality. I experience a profound sense of compression as well, if not oppression, a pressure that feels physical upon the body, on the eyes, even though there is no thing there. And the most extreme of these, I think, experiences are the dark space projects. And I would say that compared to some of these other works that have had this kind of impact on me, the works here are a little tame. The dark space projects are really, really dark spaces in which it takes quite a bit of time for your eyes to adjust and to begin to see anything. Even when you hold your hand right in front of your eyes, you can't see at anything. And this might be of interest to Tom or perhaps others. In a passing comment that James made to me when I was doing some interview with him, he talked about the incarceration period of being in solitary confinement and the utter darkness of that space, but that he realized from that experience that actually that we produce light, that the light comes from within, and that given time, light would enter and evacuate that darkness. Anyway, in this kind of experience, this kind of looks like early Barnett Newman too, unphotographable, I feel a loss of self. Even though I am aware that I am conscious, I cannot think. I become dumb. I enter a zone of wordless thoughts. This is Jim Turrell's term, which is to say somewhat pre-linguistic. And it's a state that I think the artist hopes to achieve for his viewers in most all his projects. Now, when you reach this point of feeling that light is emanating from your own body, from your own eyeballs, that it's your eyeballs are making the light, that light is not coming from outside, but from inside, you begin to sense a breakdown of the separation of self and everything else. You feel continuous with the vaporous field around you, whether this be darkness or light, or pure color, blue or red. You have to give up on self-possession and a sense of self or ego as an entity standing against the world, against as in form against ground. In extremes, this is not merely a matter of being disoriented. As I find the work absorbing, the work absorbs me. Even though this vision is not possible without me and only available to me through me, I also seem to don't matter. I am not matter. I am boundaryless. I am boundless. I don't exist. But this isn't even the terrifying part of Turrell's work, exactly. Turrell has said, space has a way of looking. It seems like it has a presence of vision. When you come into it, it is there. It's been waiting for you, end quote. Yes, and it eats me up, and it feels kind of scary and cool at the same time, unnerving and very intense. This is the terror. The experience of loss of self feels good. Feels comforting, exciting, and new. So the question is, does Turrell's art give you your subjectivity? That is to say, emplacement, sense of realness and presentness, immediacy and embodiment, or radically disperse and derealize your subjectivity, overwhelming you into a state of bliss and oblivion. To be in a state of a wakeful dream, is that an extrasensory hyper-awareness or a state of being lost in an illusory situation with no coordinates? First, no physical coordinates, and by extension, no social or historical coordinates. Are you a fuller, more whole subject than the fragmented and dispersed one that contemporary culture demands and produces? Or are you, as Rosalind Krauss might put it, or has put it, quote, a subject that no longer does its own perceiving, but is involved in a dizzying effort to decode signs that emerge from within a no longer mappable or knowable depth, end quote. Turrell's work maintains a kind of suspension between these two states for the viewer, or at least it has for me. And I'm calling it, on the one hand, pleasurable, and then on the other hand, terrifying, just as a convenience. I have been very well trained to be suspicious, though, of art of wow effects. So I struggle very much with Turrell's work. I think that it is, in fact, what I'm calling the terrifying aspects that make his work so timely, so popular today, a dispersal of not just vision, but the body, self, subjectivity, that seems to be simultaneously the return of the body, return of a whole self, return of subjectivity. Okay, next section, site specificity versus site customization. Okay, that's not a dark space, that's just a blank slide. In my opinion, there is a confusion between site specificity and site customization in contemporary art. Site specificity is a methodology of practice. To say that a work is site specific is to say that it prioritizes integrating and making visible and intelligible the conditions of a work's possibility of being, revealing the conditions of its existence in a particular place and time. These conditions can be various, physical or architectural, that is the conditions of the exhibition space. It can be historical, art historical, or more broadly historical, social, technological, institutional, political, economic, discursive. I wrote a whole book about it. But in site-specific art, or in other words, in site-specific art, the context or frame, in a broad and varied sense of the term, is rendered visible and intelligible within the work as a determining part of the work. It is a form of materialist self-reflexivity and premised on the impossibility of aesthetic autonomy. The work registers a cognizance of the relational basis for the meaning and for the very identity of what is a work of art. I won't go into kind of the historical sort of basis of those efforts. Now, although often referred to as site-specific, site customization is a more pervasive mode of practice today. Sometimes the work has to be adjusted to fit the site. That happens all the time. Other times, the site itself has to be altered to suit the work. I think that happened here. Mostly, these adjustments, fittings, and alterations are not made visible, and Turrell's work is impeccable in such customizations. Thus, the specificity or contingencies of the context do not ultimately impact the identity of the work in any deep way. It is a way to extend the work through replication or reconstruction without calling it as such, since site customization allows a replicated or remade work to maintain a new and unique status. I think this is just a kind of a side thought, but site customization, I think, follows a model of repetition or redoing that is more prevalent in the performing arts, like music and dance, rather than in visual art with sculpture and installation. To be sure, site customization requires careful consideration and thorough and rigorous study of the presentation context, but not in order to reveal it, make it visible or intelligible, but rather to overcome it. The artwork in such instances maintains its integrity despite, not because of the context. The work muscles contingencies out of view and out of the way. It obscures the site, sometimes eclipsing it altogether. In an interview that I did with James Turrell that ran kind of as a statement, really, in Art Forum, he did talk about his desire to, for the first time, reveal the structure of his piece at the, in this installation, that is to say, not the part that you would experience from inside the rotunda, but what produces that effect, that he would maybe make that available, visible, for people who would walk the ramps. It didn't happen that way here, and I don't know that he even voiced this desire to the curators. It sounds like he didn't. But that would have been another work, right? Now, in an earlier essay on Turrell's work, I asserted that in order for the artist to become the current celebrated artist of seemingly the most immaterial of materials, that is light, he has had to engage with arguably the most material of cultural practices, that is architecture. Actually, many artists of Turrell's generation who sought to challenge or reject the white cube context of art or containment of art seriously engaged with architecture in various ways. And these are just a few examples of works from the 60s and 70s, William Anastasi's photo canvas, or Bachner calling out the space of the gallery, or Michael Asher through his removals of architecture revealing the conditions of a gallery site. But where is the work of these artists, whereas in the works of these artists, the existing details and features of the gallery's architecture are purposefully made visible as the point of the work, they draw your attention to it, Turrell's work erases these details and features. And while institutional critique artists in general endeavor to unmask the conventionality of the white cube, to expose the hidden ideological functions of its seeming neutrality, Turrell proposes that the neutrality of the white cube is actually not neutral enough. All architectural details that might catch the viewer's eye, you know, like a wall socket, light switch, you know, thermostat, all that, which might assert themselves in the viewer's consciousness, are overridden in the artist's seamless counter-architecture. This is another Ganzfeld installation. As he said, quote, I'm interested in the, so this is the entry, oops, sorry. This is the entrance, you walk up, kind of like a temple front, and then this is what's inside. I'm interested in the weights, pressures, and feelings of the light inhabiting space itself, and in seeing this atmosphere rather than the walls. The artist makes an important distinction between what he calls architecture of form and architecture of space. The former, that is a form, draws the viewer's cognitive attention to the reality of the walls and all that they represent and do. Architecture of space, in contrast, erases these walls in order to awaken the viewer's somatic intelligence to feel and experience a different reality, that of the presence of light and the atmosphere. This different reality, which produces the kind of split subjective experience I described earlier, cannot be dismissed, as it might be, by some critical sectors of the art world as delusional fantasy or illusionistic, because what you see is what you see. I would go so far as to say that for Turrell, what we normally take as a reality, say the architecture of a room, is still not reality. It is a false reality constructed by humans as real. And in order to see the real, we have to counter that false reality or an unreality. Which is to say, yes, it is true. Turrell's work allows us to see new dimensions of not only light, but also our perceptual capacities. Yes, we can experience light as material and see ourselves seeing in unprecedented ways. But this expanded vision is at a cost. It is paradoxically predicated on blindness too, as I mentioned at the outset. We have to give something up in order to access this experience. The framing context has to be obscured, rendered invisible, as if it didn't exist, in order to see light as is and experience space and atmosphere as is. So Turrell's site customization, and I would say not site specificity, requires site effacement, not so much integration or intervention, but the trumping of the site. More so, I think, and more complete than what Hal Foster has said of Dan Flavin's work, that it is not so much site-specific, but site-erosive, that is Flavin, according to Foster. Turrell's approach to hide, repress, cover over, or disappear the site recalls an ethics of art making, though, voiced by an installation artist avant la lettre, James McNeil Whistler, who wrote in 1892, quote, "A picture is finished when all traces of the means used to bring about the end has disappeared." He's not a process artist. Continuing, to say of a picture, as is often said in its praise, that it shows great and earnest labor is to say that it is incomplete and unfit for view. Industry in art is a necessity, not a virtue, and any evidence of the same in the production is a blemish, not a quality. A proof, not of achievement, but of absolutely insufficient work, for work alone will efface the footsteps of work. As you see, I am very contradictory. Next section, illusionist literalism, or literalist illusionism. Turrell's work does not picture light, represent light, describe light, but delivers light. It is not seen by the artist, then rendered to be relayed in another form elsewhere at another time, what the artist calls vicarious art. We might think of, for instance, as an example of vicarious art, an impressionist painting of water lilies on a pond by Claude Monet, for example. Instead, it is presented in the here and now. Even if sometimes the artist's installations feel like smoke and mirrors or magician-like trickery, what we see is not an illusion of light, but light itself, literally. If we feel faked out, a flat plane is actually a recessed space, for example, it is because our eyes have played a trick on us, not the artist. We have perceived inaccurately. On this issue of fake and literal illusion, fake, not fake, I wanted to also share his refusal to accept the distinction between natural and artificial light. This is the MoMA piece with the light behind the benches kind of uplit, so that then it alters the color of the sky as you would see it. He, for all light for him is in a way natural, in that it's basically a color, and the color is set off by the temperature and the materials that's being burned. So he distinguishes between outside and inside light. So that's another place at which this issue of what's real and what's not real, what's an illusion and literal or fake and not fake, gets a little bit kind of off kilter. Here's works that incorporate inside light to manipulate outside light. Okay, back to the illusionism-literalism question. For Rosalind Krauss, Turrell's work epitomizes the dark side of minimalism. Quote, "Turrell's work is a function of the way a barely perceptible luminous field in front of one appears gradually to thicken and solidify, not by revealing or bringing into focus the surface which projects this light, a surface which we as viewers might be said to perceive, but rather by concealing the vehicle of the color and thereby producing the illusion that it is the field itself that is focusing, that it is the very object facing one that is doing the perceiving for one," end quote. She's a minimalist. This is the derealized subject I described earlier, the subject of postmodernism's hysterical sublime, to borrow Fred Jameson's term. For art historian Hal Foster, the dispersive opticality of light and space art is a transformation and an expanded manifestation of illusionism, of pictorial and spatial virtuality, untrustworthy, that was openly negated but secretly retained in minimalism's advocacy of what you see is what you see literalism. In his six paragraphs on Dan Flavin essay from 2005, he states, quote, "With Flavin, the literal does not correct the illusionistic. Rather, it is subsumed by it. And the same might be said of our own bodies in the midst of his work. At its extreme, his colored light overwhelms our visual apparatus. Beyond any optical mixing, his light seems to exist in our dazzled eyes," end quote. To me, that sounds more like Turrell than Flavin. In Flavin's works I've seen, I have actually not had this kind of extreme experience. As noted before, in Flavin's work, there is always the fixture, the fluorescent tube, the object to look at, ostensibly from the hardware store. The viewer does not lose his or her mastery of the bedazzlement. In this important text, Foster realigns Flavin's work away from the minimalism of Judd, Morris, and Andre on the East Coast and nudges him toward light and space art of Robert Irwin and James Turrell and others on the West Coast. I'm not sure if the geographical split is really that important, but Foster argues there that Flavin's art, quote, "which releases the opticality of a Poons or Olitsky painting in the spatial medium of colored light, aligns him with the genealogy of art that often involves conditions of immersion and effects of bedazzlement. If the prominence of an artist like Olafur Eliasson, and we might add Turrell now, is any indication, this once secondary line, which effectively, the secondary line of immersion and bedazzlement, which effectively undoes the materialist dimension of minimalism, its will to specify the object, viewer, and space, is now dominant. And this devolution might be taken to represent a catastrophe in the etymological sense of a downturning. It represents the catastrophe of minimalism." Strong words. It seems to me in Turrell's perceptual art, it's a term that's offered by the artist to distinguish his work from those advanced by artists of his generation, such as minimal art and conceptual art, there is not the subsuming of literalism by illusionism, as perhaps in Flavin's, but a literalism that might as well be illusionism. Or do I really mean that? I'm not sure. While the relational relay between object, viewer, and space is central to minimalism's bottom line, I am not sure that they are relevant to Turrell's practice at all, since all three elements are rendered radically unstable beyond the destabilization of much of the new avant-garde art of his generation. There is not enough there of any of the three to even be in relation to one another. As I said, there's no object, and the viewer is a mess. The distinctions of the three are fused into an experience of pure sensation. It's both pre- and post-subjective. It's pre- and post-objective. It's pre- and post-linguistic. His is an art of intensities. In this regard, what was repressed and denied in minimalism, that is, illusionism, is here delivered as a gorgeous spectacle of literalism. Or is it the reverse? That what was championed in minimalism, that is, literalism, is delivered here as a gorgeous spectacle of illusionism. Final section. What about Monet? As is well known, the late paintings by Claude Monet, the Water Lily series, are in situ views of a particular place, that of the Pond Garden at the artist's home in Giverny, France. Completed while the artist struggled with failing eyesight and with his country at war, Monet endeavored to capture the ineffable views of his flowers, the trees, the light, the water, the sky, and the air that he saw and felt around him as empirical truths, even if or as transitory perceptual phenomenon. Curiously, this effort to represent the immediacy of a place as experience through the ever-changing conditions of light and climate was always mediated by Monet's projections of another place, that is of Japan. Like other Impressionist painters, Monet's pictorial and painterly innovations were strongly influenced by Japanese photographs, prints, and other objets d'art japonais that were coveted by enthusiasts of Japonisme in the second half of the 19th century in France. The artist even installed a footbridge, which he painted many times, a Japanese footbridge at Giverny, providing, one conjectures, a double vision of a here and an elsewhere when he looked upon his garden. But I digress. Relevant to our discussion here, it is also well known that Monet, projecting into a future beyond his death, imagined an encompassing condition for the viewing of his water lily cycle, in which the oversized canvases would be permanently affixed to the walls of two elliptical galleries at the L'Orangerie in Paris. This is the initial installation. And this is one of the pieces, and this is a more recently renovated scene. In doing so, he hoped to present not just gorgeous atmospheric images of a particular place, his garden, but for the museum's galleries to be transformed into a unique spatial and perhaps a light experience. He aspired to use his paintings to make an elsewhere inside the museum, to deliver Giverny, and to ask of his viewers that they reorient themselves in relation to this new place light experience. This is what Turrell calls vicarious art, not what he trades in. Counter to his effort to make this experience an unmediated one, direct and literal. In a 1988 essay, Charles Stuckey positioned Monet's water lilies at the L'Orangerie as the progenitor of installation art, which I think is arguable, and linked the work to a range of artists of the 1960s generation, including Anastasi and Solowit, as well as Walter de Maria and James Turrell. Stuckey observed that one of the pioneers of so-called installation art, he's referring to Warhol, apparently appreciated the fact that Orangerie's Monet rooms were the first in the history of Western art designed exclusively for non-utilitarian, non-ceremonial visual meditation. As such, the Orangerie murals initiated one of the most pervasive and ambitious developments of the 60s, 70s, and 80s, even if so far most of the new art rooms have of necessity been on view only on a temporary basis, awaiting the sort of enlightened patronage that Clemenceau encouraged for Monet's paintings. I'm no expert on Monet, so someone else could fill in on this connection. But my final thoughts, a genealogy to track this artistic drive, the drive beyond the object and image, drive toward the creation of immersive, dazzling, totalized environments and experiences of light and space. Call it an installation, if you will, but that seems pretty inadequate. This art historical work, anyway, of tracking the genealogy will require, I think, definitely a critical reassessment of minimalism for sure, but a farther back historical view beyond minimalism. The current moment, with the museum now able to become the source of light, to contain the sun, are we in the cathedral or in Vegas? Both are temples of spirit of sorts, no? With the museum now able to do this, this drive is probably not so much a return of the repressed of minimalism, so much as a belated arrival of under-recognized and under-articulated dimensions of modernism, catastrophic or otherwise. And underneath, hidden from view of Aten Rain, is a structure that is a stepped ziggurat that also resembles a little bit, to me, Tatlin's monument to the Third International. But that's probably wishful thinking. Thank you.
It's a delight to be back in the Peter Lewis theater, where for 4 or 5 years I ran the Peter Lewis Critical Issues Forum. So I know from those exercises how much goes into organizing such an event. And Nat and Carmen and Christine are to be commended on how well they have done this. As Nat indicated, I teach religion and philosophy. Though I have what I often describe as an expanded notion of the religious, and often say that religion is most influential where it's least obvious. I believe there's a religious or spiritual dimension to all of culture. And indeed, the Guggenheim and its history are testimony to that. The museum would not exist without Hilla Ribe. It was originally, as most of you know, the Museum of Non-Objective Art, and was to be devoted originally to only three artists, one of whom was Kandinsky, whose work was always thoroughly informed by his theosophical interests and leanings. As a student of religion, it's been interesting to listen to the first two talks because they both dealt with religion or spirituality, Tom explicitly and Miwon implicitly. For those with ears to hear, it was clear that the descriptions that Miwon was talking about of her own response to Turrell's art was thoroughly suffused with mystic discourse, whether in Eastern or Western traditions, the loss of self, the sense of the sublime and the like. That dimension of it was erased, either intentionally or unintentionally, and the erasure itself might be something worth discussing. It's not atypical. There is a distinction drawn between religion and spirituality, religion being more institutional, spirituality being less so. But whichever way one thinks about it, it seems to me, the three fundamental issues that are at stake in these belief systems, God, self, and world. God, or that which is taken to be real, cosmology, anthropology, and some kind of theology, and how one envisions any of those influences, how one influences the rest. The shift that took place, and I'm going to talk about that this afternoon, in a certain way, from expressing human spiritual strivings, that shift really took place at the end of the 19th century, in the work that came out of Kant and post-Kantians, where the definition that became normative for modern art continues down to the present day was formed. And that's part of the context in which I want to place Turrell's work this afternoon. Miwon talked about the loss of self. I want to talk about the creation of the world in Turrell's art. The question James Turrell's art poses is not merely what is the work of art, but more revealing, where does art work? How does art work? When does art work? In Turrell's displacements, the work of art shifts from noun to verb, from thing to process or event, from object to subject, from space to time. The work of art, like everything else, has become questionable with the critical turn of reflection that can be traced to Kant's critical philosophy at the end of the 18th century. In the third critique, the Critique of Judgment, which was published in 1790, Kant formulated the definition of the work of art that, as I've said, became normative for modernism. Less often noticed is the importance of the first critique, the Critique of Pure Reason, published in 1781. Kant published three critiques, Critique of Pure Reason, 1781, Critique of Practical Reason, 1788, Critique of Judgment, 1790. They took the three fundamental questions of truth or knowledge, ethics, willing, the second critique, or aesthetics, beauty, the third critique. In the Critique of Judgment, Kant was concerned primarily less with the question of what we know than with the question of how we know. More precisely, critical reflection turns thought back on itself in an effort to identify the conditions of the possibility of knowledge, morality, and aesthetic judgment through what is known as transcendental analysis, conditions of the possibility of knowing, willing, and aesthetic judgments. This critical turn, and critical here doesn't mean negative, it means this kind of self-reflexivity of thought thinking about its own conditions, or morality thinking about its own conditions. This critical turn led to what is known as Kant's Copernican Revolution, which discloses that the world as we know it is not simply found, but is or discovered, but is created by knowing subjects. Though he never presented his argument in precisely these terms, Kant in effect translates ontology into epistemology, thereby shifting the locus of creativity from the divine to the human realms. Ontology concerns notions of being, epistemology of knowing, the shift from what he does is to rethink ontology, questions of being in terms of epistemology, questions of knowing. From this point of view, philosophy becomes an exploration of what Nelson Goodman has aptly described as the ways of world making. For Kant, there's only one way of world making, because he insists the mind is, in today's terms, hardwired. That is to say, we all process the data of experience the same way. What had mistakenly been taken to be the objective world existing independently of knowing subjects, Kant argues, is really fashioned or figured through the categories of the understanding, unity, plurality, causality, and the like, and the forms of intuition, space and time, all of which are purportedly universal. The world as we know it is created by bringing together the unorganized data of experience, which forms with the forms of intuition, space and time, and the categories of the understanding to form a coherent vision of the world that Kant deems rational. In a more contemporary idiom, the structures of the mind function like a computer program that processes the incoming data in a uniform way. While individuals' experiences may vary, the way in which they are processed does not. The agency through which this creative analysis, the synthesis of the data of experience, and the data of experience and forms of knowing occurs, is the imagination. Like the Platonic demiurge, fashioning matter into form, the imagination organizes the sensible manifold of experience into coherent patterns. Martin Heidegger correctly identifies the far-reaching implications of Heidegger's argument, and I quote, "If ontological knowing is schema-forming, then therewith it creates from out of itself the pure look or image. Is it not the case, then, that even ontological knowledge, which occurs in the transcendental power of the imagination, is creative? And if the ontological knowing, if ontological knowing forms transcendence, which in turn constitutes the essence of finitude, then is not the finitude of the transcendence burst asunder because of this creative character, still Heidegger? Does not the finite creature become infinite through his creative behavior?" Close quote. In different terms, again, the creator God dies and is reborn as humankind's creative imagination. This is precisely what Wallace Stevens means when he writes that God and the imagination are one. In the years following Kant's death, his general interpretation of world-making was widely accepted, but significantly revised. Rather than universal, the forms of intuition and categories of understanding came to be regarded as relative or historical. Critics and analysts concluded that the mind is not hardwired, but adapts to changing forms of production and reproduction, and therefore does not operate in the same way in different times and places. Artists were among the first to realize that human inventions are technological prostheses that transform the mind into their own image. During the closing decades of the 19th century, a series of mechanical inventions that altered perception and transformed artistic practices, ranging from the photograph gun in 1882, the kinescope, 1894, zoopraxiscope in 1893, the phantoscope, 1894, and cinematography in 1895. As new technologies caused the world to morph before people's eyes, psychologists and medical doctors, as well as artists, began to investigate problems of perception. If the world as it had been known for centuries is constructed rather than discovered, the question becomes, how is the world created? In search of answers, many artists shifted their attention from representing the world to exploring how we first perceive and then comprehend it. The result was an unprecedented succession of artistic innovations: impressionism, divisionism, pointillism, suprematism, cubism, vorticism. In all these movements, artists were obsessed with the interplay between fragmentation and integration, fission and fusion, analysis and synthesis in the ways of world making. They distinguished themselves less by the treatment of the analytic than the synthetic moment of world making. Some argued that whatever coherence the world and our experience have is primarily conceptual. Some maintained that it is primarily perceptual. And of course, some insisted that it is a mix of concepts and sensations. In an effort to plumb the depths of perception, some artists turned to the latest scientific research on vision. Georges Seurat and Paul Signac, for example, appropriated the most recent discoveries about color, shadows here that make the text hard to read, appropriated the most recent discoveries about color, optical effects, and perception by scientists like Hermann von Helmholtz and Michel Savarirol, who discovered, much to their surprise, that color is not mixed on the palette, but in the eye. Perception of a particular color is a contrast effect produced by the interaction of contiguous colors. Savarirol invented a color wheel consisting of primary colors and intermediate shades to demonstrate that color depends upon context. Two colors in proximity appear to be a third color, different from either when perceived separately. By testing different combinations, scientists and artists thought it was possible to identify complementary colors that could be used to modulate the emotions of the viewers. Art is harmony, Seurat writes. Harmony is the analogy of the contrary and of similar elements of tone, of color, of line, considered according to their dominance under the influence of light in gay, calm, or sad combinations. The work that indirectly links Kant's critical philosophy, the technological inventions at the end of the 19th century, and the artistic innovations of the early 20th century of art with James Turrell is Merleau-Ponty's Phenomenology of Perception, which was published in French in 1945 and in English in 1962. This seminal work had a major impact on many artists, some as different as Turrell, Richard Serra, and Robert Morris. By patiently probing the subconscious processing of perception, Merleau-Ponty confirmed Kant's insight. We do in fact create the worlds in which we dwell. This creation, however, for Merleau-Ponty, is more perceptual than conceptual, as it was for Kant. More precisely, the perceptual processing that shapes our worlds takes place prior to and is the condition of the possibility of conceptual articulation of the world. Turrell, in effect, recast Merleau-Ponty's Phenomenology of Perception as the work of art, verb work. Implicitly following Kant's critical turn, Turrell bends reflection back on itself to create the possibility of seeing. Art becomes critical, and critical reflection becomes the work of art. With this critical turn, art becomes transcendental analysis, whose aim is to affect the conditioned, is to reveal the conditions of the possibility of vision and thereby expose the dynamics of world making. Turrell's concern, however, is not merely philosophical and psychological, but is also artistic and, as I've suggested, it's also spiritual. Throughout his career, Turrell has been preoccupied with the art of vision. In an interview, in 1996 interview, he describes Rodin craters in terms that are strikingly reminiscent of the views of Kant and his followers that I have just described. Our vision, and I quote here, our vision is not rectilinear. Our vision is sort of two spheres that actually make an ellipsoid shaping of the perceptual field. You notice the ellipsis in so many works, including the current work here in the Guggenheim. So if you can create spaces that are rectilinear and still have them neutral in this very curvilinear, voluptuous earth form of the volcano in which all forms are actually parabolical or elliptical. There's one circular part of the crater that is actually within 7 feet of being a circular radius of 800 feet. It is, with, as I say, within 7 feet of being a perfect circle, which Turrell says is amazing. This gives me a way to make curvilinear spaces neutral, whereas it is not quite appropriate in museums and spaces that are rectilinear. The rectangle, sort of slightly off square, is much more neutral than a circle or an ellipse in these situations. Otherwise, it can become shaped canvases. When you come in, you can see that there is a forming of form. And that's a phrase I want you to remember, the forming of form. But what becomes very positive is that this thing in between the space is the work that I do. At the center, I make architecture of space, and I use forms to capture light, to hold it in a way, to give it form, to give it space to reside. The work of art functions for Turrell like the imagination for Kant. It is the forming of form, the figuring of figure, always forming but never form, always figuring but never figured. Art emerges at the borders and margins of what Stevens poetically describes as the edgings and inchings of final form. Indeed, from this point of view, all art is, in Heidegger's terms, poesis, a making that is a forming or figuring. Rather than a created object, the work of art is a subjective process that is not limited to the artist as traditionally defined. For Turrell, as for Boyce and Warhol, though in a very different way, everyone is an artist. Through imaginative activity, individuals and communities create the personal and social worlds in which they live. Wherever form is forming, the imagination is at work and worlds are emerging. What Turrell recognizes that many others do not is that the process of world making begins at the most rudimentary levels of perception and apprehension. Subject and object, interiority and exteriority, are not fixed opposites, but are intertwined and codependent. They don't simply disappear, though in moments they do. If the imagination is the activity of figuring that delimits figures, then it can be understood as something like an information process that occurs wherever figures are articulated. The so-called natural world is a work of art designed by an anonymous artist whose work we momentarily figure. In a startling observation, and this is a remarkable observation, Turrell goes so far as to suggest that the world becomes aware of us in our awareness of it. My art, he concludes, is an art that is not about my seeing. It's about your direct perception of the work. I'm interested in having light, a light that inhabits space so that you feel it to be physically present. I mean, light is a substance that is in fact a thing, but we don't attribute thingness to it. We use light to illuminate other things, or something we read, sculpture, or paintings. And it gladly does this. But the most interesting thing to find is that the light is aware that we are looking at it, so that it behaves differently when we are watching it than when we are not, which imbues it with consciousness. The reference is, of course, to the Heisenberg uncertainty principle and the wave particle theory of light, so memorably explored in Tom Stoppard's play, Hapgood. Not only is Rodin Crater an oculus designed to enable us to enter, to enable those who enter it to see light, Turrell goes so far as to suggest that it is actually an eye in which light sees itself in our seeing it. Here, reflexivity is doubled, creating loops that are virtually infinite. Rodin Crater, Turrell insists, has knowledge in it, and it does something with that knowledge. Environmental events occur. A space lights up. Something happens there for a moment or for a time. It is an eye, something that is itself perceiving. It is a piece that does not end. It is changed by the action of the sun, the moon, and the cloud cover. And what day or what season that you're there, it keeps shining. And you're there, it has, and when you're there, it has visions, qualities, and possibilities of a universe of possibilities. Science, philosophy, art, and now religion. Rodin Crater is a ritual space crafted to refigure vision. As in many religious traditions, the site of transformation is the desert. To reach Rodin Crater, it is necessary to undertake a pilgrimage that is long and can be demanding. In Turrell's words, and I quote, "The main thing is to make the journey so that you can actually do something, so that you can actually go to something purposefully and have time to settle down and empty out the noise and distractions of daily life. Often we can shift gears more quickly in places like a church or a library, perhaps because they are designed to be places of silent reflection. Most people, by the time they arrive at the crater, are pretty well set up for it. So it would be wonderful if the visitors could spend at least 24 hours, but it would be better to stay longer. Serious art takes time. Time to create and time to appreciate, which most people in today's high-speed 24/7 world think they do not have. I want to show you some slides of Rodin Crater and describe a little bit my experience of it. So what you see, some of these are familiar, some are not. It's hard to get I at least found it was hard to get a sense of the actual experience of the crater from the photographs and images of it. This is the road approaching it. It's about 40 minutes north of Flagstaff. This is the inside of the bowl of the crater, which he's sculpted. There are two openings. This central one here, which is surrounded. The stonework here has been done by Navajo craftsmen. I'll come back to this. The territory of the crater borders the Navajo and Hopi reservations. And the stonework is absolutely exquisite. I'll show another image of this central opening in a minute. When you approach the crater, it's all cinder road about halfway up, there's a place to park. And he's built one of what will be two and how to describe it, sort of lodge-type rooms, but they are beautifully done architecturally. They look sort of like a Tao Ando creation. The one they have now has four bedrooms and a kitchenette and the like. Eventually they'll have at least one other one. And as the quotation I read suggested, his aim ultimately is that the people who visit the crater will be able to stay for at least 24 hours. As you enter the crater, the main entrance, you enter a room that's probably about roughly as big as this stage double, that is completely dark, and has this black marble with this white stone in the middle. The base, the floor, as it is in many places, is black gravel, carefully raked as if it were a Zen garden. As Miwon was saying, these things take time to adjust. This, as you enter that room, to the right is this passageway. It too is dark. Let me go back. It's 935 feet. The grade is 8%, so it's a relatively steep grade. The day we were there a couple of years ago, everything was in crisis because the paint with which this had been painted was peeling. And that completely screwed up the light from Terrell's point of view. About halfway up this passageway, there is a retractable convex mirror that's roughly the size of that white stone that I showed you. And this is all, it's all aligned so that every, I think it's 18 years, I think it is, the sun or the moon shines in the opening down there through that lens and projects the image onto the white stone at the bottom. At the end, and one of the, it doesn't come through in this photograph so much, maybe in one of the others. One of the things that's extraordinary is when you're going up this passageway, it has the shape of a keyhole almost, and it looks like at the top there's an opening on the wall at the far end. But as soon as you step over, and it happens instantaneously, as soon as you step over the threshold into this opening, which is the opening on the side of the crater, you see that what had appeared to be on the wall is in fact this opening to the sky, with these stairs going upward. This is the keyhole over to the left of this one room. Near opening is what we were just inside of. The other opening we'll come to in a minute. I like this picture because it has the truck alongside it, so it gives you a sense of the scale of this work. We're now going to go inside that central structure there, that opening, and this is what is inside. So the exhibition upstairs mimics the crater, so the benches around that. Here we have more black gravel, exquisite rose-colored sandstone here, and the craftsmanship is extraordinary. And this now looks up into the sky. It's a skylight of it. This is right outside that central area. There is this passageway that takes you to the outside of the crater, or to the outside of the room. And one of the extraordinary, and it only takes you a few seconds to get outside. And one of the extraordinary things in the experience of the sky, the sky space is the colors that you see through the opening, and this is part of that color wheel point that I was making, are completely different from the color of the sky when you look at it outside the opening. This is the central area, which has four of these, whatever they are here. This is my wife lying on it. And they are constructed so that you lie like that. There's a ridge where you put your head. And this is one of the things that has always fascinated Turrell. When you get your eyes aligned, and he's carved, I guess the right thing, the interior of the volcano, so it's perfectly symmetrical. When you get the edge of the opening of the crater lined up with your eyes, you have, again, it's a flip experience, what they call celestial vaulting. And it lines up, and suddenly, it's like one of those gestalt, you know, figure ground thing. It appears as if there is a vault over the sky. Time is always short. 20 to 30 minutes max, I was told. How could we comprehend a lifetime's work in 20 minutes? Turrell's work does not so much take time as give time. Time to think, time to ponder. Time we think we don't have in this world, rest world. And by giving that time, it allows us perhaps to see what we normally overlook. The eye of the crater is like the shutter of Muybridge's camera that exposes the invisible by showing everything, by slowing everything down. We were fortunate enough to visit the Guggenheim Museum exhibition for the first time when the museum was closed, so we could spend time, as much time in the rotunda as we wanted or was needed. The museum was also quiet, creating a space that allowed time for concentration, reflection, even meditation. The duration of the work, and this work is about duration, is an hour, though few people, of course, think they have time, that much time to spend with a work of art. Outside and inside, natural and artificial mix without ever matching. While the program repeats again and again and again, no hour is ever the same. The atrium, like the crater, is open to the sky, and therefore the light is always different. And these differences matter in ways that we can only begin to understand if we slow down long enough to allow art to do its work. For every work of art, place, which is not the same as space, matters as much as time. Fifth Avenue is obviously very different from the Arizona desert, even if the Guggenheim appears to be something like an inverted volcanic cone. The crater literally immerses one in ancient geological time that exposes today's real time to be as unreal and to be unreal, and for people to remember the long arc of history that carries the imagination back to ancient rituals. Rising from the valley floor on the edge of the painted desert north of Flagstaff, the volcanic cone resembles the kiva, where nearby Navajo and Hopi tribes hold their rituals of death and rebirth through which vision is transformed. Recognizing the similarity of these spaces, Gene Sepsutawa, a Navajo craftsman who worked with Turrell on the stonework of that area, suggested that the central opening of the volcano be named the Su Kiva. This is a drawing or painting of the myth of origin for the Hopi. And according to this myth of origin, there was at one time a catastrophe. The people who lived on the earth retreated underground where they lived for a while. And the site of origin is a mound at the mouth of the Colorado River, which is one of the borders of the land that Turrell owns out there. The creation myth involves these people coming from underground into through the opening at the top and into the world. The the kivas, which are used in rituals, reenact this whole thing. So it becomes a ritual space of, in a certain sense, death and rebirth. As one enters that 930, that opening, and then that 935-foot tunnel or passageway into the open space, it is impossible for one who studies religion not to understand this as, in a certain sense, a reenactment of ancient rituals of death and rebirth. Far from an autonomous object, this work of art, wrote in Curator, draws you in and allows you to explore inner space. As you move deeper, an unexpected reversal occurs. Having entered the work of art, inner and outer space fold into each other, and the work of art now enters you. When I visited Rodin Crater, late one autumn afternoon, so I could experience the twilight, the work of art at twilight. Winding my way through the labyrinthian tunnels, I eventually reached the stunning rose white circular stone of the Sioux Kiva, which I've shown you images, which is open to the sky. At the center of this arresting space, carefully raked pitch black lava cinders form the pupil of what Turrell calls the crater's eye. Sitting on the rose sandstone bench circling the room, it's a similar experience to what you had, I think, Miwon. I was absorbed by the soft light radiating upward that cast a golden glow on the white walls. Looking skyward through what resembled the aperture of a camera obscura, I had the uncanny feeling of being inside my own eyeball. Leaning back and staring intently at the circular opening, the sky lost all depth and appeared to be a perfectly executed monochromatic painting. But the colors of this work of art were unlike any I had ever seen. The intense hues changed constantly, but imperceptibly. During the 10 minutes immediately before and after sunset, the sky turned shades of blue and black that appear on no spectrum and elude all words. Like shifting colors on Savril's color wheel, the dim reflections of the reds, ambers, and umbras of the desert floor, created subtle shades of lavender that enriched the blues of the sky. As darkness deepened, blues turned to black, or more precisely, blacks. Who knew there were so many blacks? The sky, just after sunset, revealed that black, like every other color, is not one color, but many colors. The exhibition did not end when the sun drifted below the horizon. The colors kept changing as light arriving from the origin of the universe bent back around the Earth's curved surface and entered my sphere of vision. It was as if I were gazing into the empty depths of heaven. Slowly, Crater's eye and my eye joined, and time stopped. I became the work of art. At this moment, I realized that to see seeing is to be present at the creation of the world. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, all three of you, for these provocative and exciting papers, which we will return to discuss in half an hour. We're going to take a coffee break. There are refreshments out the way you came in, I believe. So we'll be back here at 6. One word before you get up. If anyone did write down questions for us to review on those little cards, please be sure to drop them with members of our staff, and they'll make their way up to us so that we can review them before the discussion at 6. Thank you. Welcome back. First off, thank you to all three of you for these great papers. This was a very intense and heady hour and a half of talks, and there's a lot that we can talk about, a lot of bigger things and a lot of little things, and I have a whole stack of questions from the audience, so we've got our work cut out for us over the next 45 minutes or so. I guess I would like to start and start with more of sort of a response, which will come sort of out of your paper, Miwon, in part because craftily, you were the one person who didn't give me your paper beforehand, so, and then also you were the one who sort of spoke most directly to the exhibition here.
I was working on it till 2:30.
Which is fine, understood. I think my initial sort of statement will come out of some of the things that you said, but will also hopefully link into Tom and Mark's papers so that we can all start talking. And I'd like to sort of preface it by asking an initial question, and then I'll move on and we can maybe come back to this question, which is probably something you've thought about before, but your sort of delineation between site specificity and site customization. And I'm wondering if there's a sort of a third term that's in between that's more like site responsiveness that is somehow I don't know, a middle ground between sort of avoiding and mystifying the frame and the context of the location and the history and completely engaging it 100%. Mm-hmm. And I suppose, like to suggest that at least in terms of talking about the work here, that maybe we're, maybe we could think through something along those lines. With that said, and sort of set aside, I'd actually like to propose something different altogether, which is, could we consider the site that is being addressed in the notion of site specificity with James's work actually the human eye and the perception itself? Mm-hmm. And would it perhaps be a more interesting way to not pay so much attention to the sort of historical framework of the architecture that is framing his installation so much as thinking of those spaces as instruments that are setting up a condition whereby we can engage the context and the frame and the history and the means of production of what's actually going on perceptually, and sort of refashion the idea of site specificity to address our eyes themselves or our modes of vision, even in the more cultural historical sense. I think it's interesting to think of works like Ott and Rain as instruments, in part because even when you look at Roden Crater, you look at other works. James, I mean, he's very interested in instruments of vision. He's interested in the history of cameras and optical things, also restoring airplanes, using airplanes as instruments for exploration and for different visual conditions. And I think that some of Mark's comments about craftsmanship at Roden Crater gets into that, and also Tom's sort of argument or statement towards the importance of use value and of creating things that do something, that have a use, and that use instrumentalizes the artworks to transform our perception or make us understand our perception. Mm-hmm. So anyway, that's sort of my starting point. And if any one of you has anything to say about that, probably not.
Well, you put a lot on the...
I know. So pick any one of those things, I guess. And
I think it'd be a mistake to reduce or to think of the site specificity primarily in terms of the eye. Because I think that part of what's going on here, and I mean the whole notion of instrumentality and some of what Tom said about, you know, Quaker usefulness was interesting in that kind of context, but that whole notion of instrumentality has been so fraught, again, ever since Kant. But it seems to me that what's at stake in the work is the interrelation and interactivity between sight and eye or whatever. I mean, it's not. Yes, there are moments when that subject-object opposition is elided in certain ways, but it's not simply a race in a certain way, because what he's interested in is the way in which the interaction takes place. And you don't want to think it simply, you keep the eye, but the eye, you know, and the, I mean, one way to think about this, you know, and then you begin to think about this and all the kinds of research that's going on in neuroscience and, you know, neurological implants and the like. There are ways in which, and this would be the way I would put the point that you just made. I would use the notion of prostheses in a certain way, that there's a way in which the work of art becomes a prosthetic for that transforms or affects the inner relationship with the world in a certain way.
Miwon, does that affect at all your reading of how your notion of site specificity works?
My response to your initial question about a middle ground, I guess I did present it like site specificity and customization are kind of opposed endpoints in some ways. I would say yes, I think there's definitely middle grounds. I don't know if responsive is the term I would use, but and I think in practice, there's constant kind of moving around in the two different kind of scenarios I mapped, and it's primarily for sort of conceptual clarity that I would probably pose them as so discrete and kind of incommensurate, you mm-hmm. know. But I think artists and curators and organizers of exhibition, art handlers, they're all involved in, I think, negotiating it in practice. So you could take those concepts as I mapped as kind of heuristic, helpful kind of frameworks to try to distinguish practices, perhaps. I'm realizing now that I don't know if James himself describes his work as site-specific. Others have. And that's probably what riled my feathers a little bit.
And I also think, if I'm not cutting you off, but I think as a curator, as an art worker who sometimes, often, has to deploy words outside of the, you know, more elaborated academic framework that they would be used in, using a word like site-specific is
shorthand.
It's a shorthand way to talk about this, obviously, a very fuzzy territory of creating something new for a particular space. Mm-hmm. And certainly, I would use it in a much looser way than you do when you're talking about Michael Asher's work, for instance.
Yeah, and I think that looseness is, you know, bothersome to me. Because I think a lot of different practices get categorized as sharing attributes when they don't. But I think the other idea about architecture as an instrument, I think that's definitely true that Turrell uses and creates architecture as a kind of a viewing machine, or to produce a kind of a viewing machine. And then the third thought of thinking about vision or eyes or sight, I forget, sight with the GH as the site, S-I-T-E. Mm-hmm. I have to think about that.
Fair enough.
Yeah, because part of at least the art historical context in which that term site-specific emerges doesn't take us quite there. Mm-hmm. So if we were to make that kind of a leap, what's at play, what's being presumed in that kind of a transposition of ideas, I would have to dwell on that.
Fair enough.
Don't have a ready answer on that.
Enough.
But I also don't want it to come across that somehow I think site-specific art is better than site-customized art. Mm-hmm. And that's why I quoted Whistler at length. There's something extraordinary, and of course Whistler attached a certain ethics to the possibility of the art erasing all its process, you know, and so I don't want to come across that somehow customization necessarily is a bad thing.
Okay, fair enough.
You should do it well, though.
Customize it well.
Very well.
Yes, yeah. of course. Well, I mean, it has been a really interesting, interesting thing to work through, as you mentioned, with Autumn Rain in this show, because the architectural site that it is taking place in is so loaded and noteworthy and an amazing space. And it was, without going on at too much length about, you know, about justifying an attack that is not an attack at all. So, you know, I'm not going to
a soft attack.
But is that, you know, the levels at which the, at which Aten Rain actually respects the building in a lot of ways that that other forms of specificity might not do so as much.
Yeah,
and I'm not prepared to like launch into a long diatribe about Daniel Buren and James Turrell or anything. So
the mutual constitutive aspect is what I would have, I guess, appreciated would be able to have access to that.
To the behind the scenes, you mean?
I don't think I mean just behind the scenes, but that the mutually constitute, that they exist together. Like documentation of construction or things
which
like
is
that isn't really what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
It's more that the work itself, inseparability to the
I understand
context was available. Is
I just don't find all that interesting question.
Okay. Well, let's see. We'll take it in a different direction. I mean, I was also interested coming out of Tom's talk with the sort of notion of Turrell, to pick yet another loaded word, as a maverick. I mean, I hate to use that word still, but or a prankster, and the sort of double, you know, the fact that there's at some points so much at stake in the history that you're talking about, and at other points, he was being extremely playful, and I feel like that's still something that conditions his personality. And I think it's an interesting, especially given the seriousness of much of what Mark and Miwon were talking about, to remember that there's this sort of underlying condition of a lot of play.
Yeah, I think it's a mistake. Simply put, to confuse seriousness with solemnity.
Mm-hmm.
And we have a lot of that going on. And our, you know, the general tenor of discussion around contemporary art issues that always bring, you know, these catchphrases like site specificity and criticality and so on into play are a very solemn, you know, collection of terms and rhetoric, which, you know, it would be good for everybody to lighten up. And often pieces that are invoked as you know, paradigms in this discussion. You mentioned Michael Asher. And you know, now's the piece he did in the same Pomona College Gallery, wiping out all those Renaissance paintings and all the accoutrements to make it into you know, a hollow, completely featureless space, which Turrell, I think I saw in one interview, he was expressing his fondness for that piece and his very warm recollection of it. But it now it has been erected as a foundation for the idea of institutional critique, which is another one of these solemn catchphrases, which makes the whole thing seem like a deep, furrow-browed, you know, sort of unhappy, you know, contemplation of everything, really. And the fact that the gallery, an institution, you know, presumably an oppressive institution of hieratical, you know, aesthetic values had been erased by Asher's intervention does not accord with the recollections of anyone who was actually involved in making the piece. Michael didn't actually make it much. It was Maury Baden and Hal Glicksman who actually constructed it. And when Michael would show up, he would do things like people who work in mine safety and things like have these little guns that create puffs of smoke that just hang in the air,
and then the air currents move them, and you can tell how the air is moving in an enclosed space. So Michael had one of these, and he would shoot it off and then follow it around the inside of the space, which obviously has very little to do with what we understand as institutional critique. It's about looking at the natural elements. It's about the kind of sensorium and the play. You know, it's like a little kid's, cap gun that, you know, when you're using it. And he loved the way that the it's very near the Santa Fe, Southern Pacific Railroad tracks, the way the train whistles sounded inside that space, the way they echoed and reverberated. These are, I think you can see very well on this dimension why James Turrell would really love the piece.
Mark.
Let me follow up with a question that that your talk raised. So let's juxtapose your claim, which I want to hear more about, that Turrell, given his Quaker background, was committed to a certain kind of usefulness. So one question, what would the usefulness of it, how would he understand, do you think, the usefulness of his art? That's one. Secondly, philosophically, at least, the whole way in which the notion of play in relationship to art came to be developed was its non-usefulness. You know, the purposiveness without purpose, right?
Yes, that I was whole about to say that, right. Because, you right, know, because having invoked Kant, that yeah, right. is the
right. But
that is
so,
the phrase.
So there's so on the one hand, there's this playful element, but on the other hand, there's a useful element, and indeed the whole way in which from Kant on the distinction between so-called higher art and lower art was made was between purposiveness and purposelessness, mm-hmm. right? So one, how do you see, I mean, right, given this commitment to utility, if we may call it usefulness, we can say that any art transformed or whatever has a certain, right, so how do you think, is there a distinctive way in which he understands usefulness, and then how does that balance with what you've just said about play?
Well, I was following on from, of course, this hearsay report from John Ware. But he was very emphatic about it, you know, that this is something that Turrell apparently would say, you know, frequently and, you know, express as his position, that he wasn't an art major, even though he was very involved in a very lively, college art scene there with many, you know, participants who, had very important careers or went on to real fame, you know, like say Chris Burden, for example, who was part of this. But he didn't major in art. And, that was the fact to which Ware was speaking, that he didn't want to be in a situation where, in order to fulfill his course requirements, he had to make objects that didn't have a use. So ceramics, because a vessel is, by definition, and it needn't be terribly useful or practical, but at least it has that form and that potential. And so that would make sense. So I was looking at not so much investing what he ultimately did as necessarily having use, but avoiding objects that lacked use, which would be the case for most actual works of art. The light, by avoiding a kind of idolatry of the work of art, and that's an area of theology I'm very interested in, is the resistance or critique of idolatry. The things that he was making in a way obviated the question of whether they were practical or useful or not. So he could be an artist without falling into the trap of idolatry, which he would never have used that word, I don't think. Mm-hmm. But it was, in a way, a way of resolving a contradiction.
That's a profoundly Protestant principle.
No.
Right. I mean, the resistance to representation,
yes.
Non-idolatrous. I mean, that's,
yeah.
And which Quakerism represents on steroids.
Yeah, it comes out of, the dissenting traditions of the 17th century and took that aspect of it to, to its most kind of profound degree.
Okay, so I guess if you can speak more into your microphones.
Okay. I've got it right up here.
Thank
but,
you.
Okay.
Sorry, I cannot see anything out there.
There's
either,
Carmen.
So I don't know what you guys are communicating to us. I'm actually going to use that. This is going to be, you know, maybe less of a heady question, but I'm going to use this to get into one of our audience questions, if I can find the audience question, which is about Monet. And about the end of your talk, only to ask, have you been to? You showed the image from Naoshima, but there's also Monet is also in view in Naoshima, and the question that we have is, if you have indeed seen both, how you know what your experience of the interaction between those are.
The reference is to. A series of exhibition spaces in the small island of Naoshima in Japan, in which one museum, which is buried underground, designed by Tadao Ando, is dedicated to the permanent installation of Monet water lilies, Walter de Maria installation, and James Turrell Ganzfeld pieces, plus I think an Afram. And it was during the visit to that site, and before I went, I thought, why is, it's basically a vanity project, this whole island, that, you know, de Maria and Turrell, contemporary artists next to each other, made sense to me, but why is Monet there? And, you know, I'm trained, as I said in my talk, very well to be skeptical. And, but the experience of seeing the Monets there in the exquisite way that they were installed, in natural light conditions also, so you could see it change. I did have an incredible artistic, like Stendhal syndrome, like, you know, moment, and, you know, I found myself crying in front of the Monets. I'm confessing. and I don't know, I kind of was quite overwhelmed by what went into them and the care that went into presenting them in this particular way. And to experience them juxtaposed to Turrell's work made it very obvious to me that the kind of appreciation or narration about Turrell's work, kind of within land art discourse, there's one. That's one. Light and space discourse is another. Site-specific art is another, and such. That it just seemed, you know, the arbitrary feat of art historians to categorize that way, and that there's maybe a through line of a different sort that we haven't really accounted for, and that in this, you know, experience I had, I must account for it somehow, you know. It's not been, you know, the most prioritized project on my table, but this was an opportunity for me to just even throw it out, you know. So there's a bigger and deeper history to tell about the work, and also to bring Monet to our present moment. Yeah.
Well, one, and this is not really my story to tell. This is James's story, but since he's not here, I'll take the liberty to tell a story that he told me about, which will link a little bit into Tom's stories of his early years. It's earlier than that, but of his first trips to New York, which when he came to see the water lilies. and, I mean, he didn't come to New York specifically for that, but his aunt lived here, and. This is totally beside the point, but just of anecdotal amusement, that apparently, I think he was 13 or 14, and apparently he and some friends had stolen a car and gotten arrested, and he had been punished by being sent to his very strict Quaker family in Indiana, and after a year spent with his with this sort of very strict punishment, he was given a summer in New York with his crazy aunt here, and she took him to see Monet, and among other things, and that was one of his first real engagements with the modern art world.
Punishment seems to be a significant part of his research.
So. Another question, which Mark, you may or may not want to answer, this is from the audience as well, is about the relationship between James's thinking or work and Buddhism, given both the experiences in Southeast Asia that Tom described and what we're talking about with Naoshima. And I mean, it's a very open question as to, has Buddhism influenced his art?
I don't do art history, I do philosophy, so I'm not interested in influence questions.
Sure.
But I am interested in, what shall I say, substance questions, or in this case, the lack of substance questions. I think that the kind of experience that Miwon was actually evoking resonates, as I suggested, profoundly with a certain kind of, I work in the Western traditions, not in Buddhism, but with certain strands of mystical discourse and experience in East and West, because there are profound similarities. It's not that they're all the same, but there are profound similarities between different strands here. So that the kind of emphasis on emptiness, on Miwon talked about the no thingness, a nothing that is not simply an emptiness, or to put it another way, an emptiness that is in a certain sense a fullness, or an absence that is somehow becomes an overwhelmingly present in this. And I also do, and I talked about this, I've seen other Turrell works, but the primary work that I'm interested in is Rodin Crater, and there's a profoundly ritualistic dimension to that space. And I was quite struck by the way the gravel had been raked. It was like temples in Kyoto in certain ways. All of those dimensions, I think, resonate quite deeply. It is interesting because I think it is very, very, very difficult to appreciate the work with a lot of people and noise.
Yeah. You know?
What he has created here is a certain kind of meditative space for meditation and contemplation. And as I suggested, that kind of experience, you must allow time for it. I mean, this stuff, and it's not just that it takes an hour for the thing to cycle, but it's a whole... why has there been the extraordinary response that there have been? Obviously, many reasons, but at least in part, it may have something to do with the high-speed world we live in and the distractions that creates, that here becomes a certain kind of secular contemplative space that allows us, that creates the opportunity for us to allow time to do its thing, or nothing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, one of the things that I've thought and said about all of Turrell's work, but that you do experience in a particular way here, is that because of the subjective experiences that you've all been talking about that he's addressing, viewers almost in every case, or anyone who engages it, has a very personal experience. And of course, it's easier to get at that if you're alone or if you're in a quiet space. But even when there are 100 people upstairs, you can still get at this because you feel like it's working on your perceptions, and there's this direct thing that when the word about that gets out, I mean, people want to feel that. They want to experience that. I think that's one of the reasons that the show has been popular.
Again, this is certainly part of what Turrell sees, and it was at the heart of Merleau-Ponty's form of phenomenology, that there is a bodily bias to perception. And that is, and what that means is that the pace and rhythms of life influence what we can or cannot apprehend. And so there are certain things that that the space and rhythms of contemporary experience make inapprehensible. Mm-hmm. And I think that that creates, and I think there is a certain kind of acknowledgement of something that's lacking or missing, and with that acknowledgement, a desire for it.
Mm-hmm. I'm curious too, I mean, something I've thought about a lot during the show is, given this individual meditative experience that his work fosters, but then seeing artworks with a lot of people, is there some new direction or new way of thinking through Turrell works as social spaces? And are those things contradictory inherently? Does it automatically become spectacle if it's a large social environment? Or, you know, how do those two tensions play out, or how might they play out in an ideal scenario?
Yeah, I've had some thoughts about that. I would say, first of all, not all of his works function in the same way.
No, they don't. They absolutely don't.
In fact, it makes his body of work much more differentiated than one would perhaps assume on the basis of the language that's customarily applied to them. You know, where you're in a space where you can't see, or can see only very dimly, it's not going to be very communal.
No, and in addition, at least to the dark spaces I've been in, only two people can be in there at a time.
Yeah.
I mean,
they're disorienting in an anxiety-provoking way, because you can run into a wall and so on. So, your fellow participants in the space don't help you very much. But some of the sky spaces that I have seen, where what the piece does happens very slowly, they're symmetrical. There are, you know, there's seating, which is an invitation to sit in a square, and spend a lot of time seeing who else is there along with you while you all wait for, you know, for the sky to darken at dusk and so on. And that is a space where it does seem to me a temporary fellowship mm-hmm. is created, where people are being moved in a way that other people can observe, or maybe moved to speech. And you know, you can hear me veering very close to another sense of Quakers and the Quaker meeting, where nothing yeah. happens unless somebody is moved.
But Tom, because I was thinking when you underscored that he didn't major in art and he majored in psychology in some way. I mean, there are times with some of these works you think, well, maybe he's still doing psychology, that these are sort of, you know, that these are almost experiments in perceptual psychology somehow.
Yes. Well, I think if we add, you know, not simply individual psychology, but social psychology.
Yeah, right. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I was going to say that there are models of collective communal experience mm-hmm. in Turrell's
Absolutely,
work already, and I think the meeting houses are my favorites.
And for those of you who don't know, he's designed at least, I think, two Quaker meeting houses now, and one of his first sky spaces, which is at PS1, is called Meeting.
Yeah.
So it's something he explicitly mm-hmm. evokes.
And I think the crucial aspect is silence, though. It's a communal space of individuals kind of coexisting, but not necessarily themselves. Well, it raises questions about the nature of communion, I guess. But what I was struck by was what allowed for that collective experience of something together was a kind of silence. And the silence created a kind of, at least for me, maintaining this kind of balance of my separation from others, but also being co-present with others. And perhaps that's why I thought no language was like part of an attribute that I would put to his work. But so the model of a collective appreciation is already, I think, in his work. But I'm not sure the museum is the ideal setting for that kind of
Yeah, that's a larger a larger and difficult question, which we won't get into right now. But what we will do, because it's 6:37, I believe, do we have any questions from the audience before we call it a night? If we do, then you should come up to the microphones. Here's one, let's see.
I have a question about site-specificity. Okay, I wrote my question down. In relation to what was being said about the historical site, what about the social and economic connotations that come with this this space or this institutional space? And I was thinking about Brian O'Doherty or Patrick Ireland, his theory about the white cube. And this unique exhibit manipulates a space to form and execute a special experience. Would you say the historical, social, institutional connotations are being dissolved in the manipulation of the space? Or would you say these connotations are being turned upside down in the process of the site manipulation for the purpose of forcing the audience to contemplate about these connotations in the special experience, the contemplated space?
My take about this particular installation is that it's not, it encourages not thinking about the social and the institutional and the political and the economic, that it wants to create its own site and kind of push those dimensions away in order for that kind of isolated, perceptual, very, you know, sensation to not be either corrupted or interrupted or disrupted by these other elements. And I think it's, that's why I said you need a blindness, is that you need to be somehow blinded in order to see what Turrell wants you to see. Does that help?
I would agree with what you're saying that, I mean, certainly I can't speak for James, but in my understanding and sort of interpretation of the work here on Rain was very much about drawing out, ironically through sort of covering up the inside of the building, to draw out qualities of the architecture and the way that light comes into the building and the sort of essence of the building in a way that would provide a more internal, subjective experience, much more than analyzing the cultural, you know, production issues with the building itself.
Yeah.
Isn't that, Nat? Just one footnote, because Mariana raised the other question she raised for the economic dimension of some of this, which we shouldn't be slighted. The evening we visited the Curator, we stayed quite late into the night and had the good fortune to be able to talk to Tom, I forget his last name now, the guy who was the engineer.
Tom McGrath.
The engineer who makes this all happen. And, of course, it's never going to be done. So I said to him, well, so what are we talking about finance-wise? He said, well, as it's envisioned now, it'll take at least anywhere between $50 and $100 million more to complete. And the next morning we get up, and I forget what, I think it was, I can't remember, it was 2008, 2009, it was not a good year. And that morning the stock market had dropped 750 points. And you know, just so the, I mean, the, so again, if we come back to utility and inutility in all of this, and how, you know, how one measures return on investment, whatever kind it is here, these are issues that get swept under the rug, but are pretty important.
Yeah, that's, James is, in his characteristic way, kind of frank and humorous about it. And I can't remember what his line is, but it's something he talks about, the return on his investment and
right.
The fact that he's lost 3 marriages and, you know, whatever else in the process of doing this.
He is a really funny person.
Yeah.
He described the experience of watch, you know, the sky space experience. Like, we were in the Roden Crater together looking up, and he said, yeah, it's like watching paint dry.
But the problem is that when the paint dries, it then peels, and that costs $150 million to redo, right?
Yeah. But one aspect that Mark's comment also reminds me of, I'm very interested in issues of labor with contemporary art,
yeah.
And not only the economic, but know-how, you know? So, you know, the support studio, the staff, the light expert, the engineer, the software programmer that makes this work possible, makes James's work possible, which generally doesn't get celebrated and even acknowledged, you know, like who makes this stuff,
right?
And so that's a kind of a materialist question. That those kinds of questions begins to mess up the kind of the work once you start asking those questions. This is why I kind of played out, almost performed my ambivalence in the talk I gave, is because the more I bring these kinds of questions to the work, the more I can't appreciate the work on the terms that the artist has asked me to.
But that's an important point. And isn't that one of the ways in which sort of art from craft is distinguished, that in a certain way, art signed with all its problems, but craft is anonymous, you know, that tends to be anonymous.
Also, I would say, you know, that interesting, jobs that are inspiring and bring out people's individual expertise to a satisfying common purpose, those kinds of jobs are getting to be in short supply. And because the general tenor of the economy is militates against that, but there are lots of artists now, the most prominent and successful artists require these support systems and employ a lot of people who are, you know, getting to do things that more routine occupations or unemployment, you know, would never afford. And, you know, I don't feel, you know, worried about the anonymity of people necessarily, you know, provided that the artist is a good boss in a way.
Yeah. Well, I will say, just because this is going to sound like jingoism for the museum, but our war show was built in-house completely. Our team was amazing, and you know, James has been actually very, very frank about that, and has remarked on it in public several times. So, for whatever that's worth, it was our own team who built it. It's actually 6:45, so I think I know people are eager to go up and see the show, and it looks like the crowd is thin, so it's going to be even better up there.
Okay.
Thank you all for coming. Thank you all for this. To exit, you'll go through not the doors you entered, but through the glass doors in this direction, up the stairs to the rotunda.